So d by d epsilon of tau ab of y plus, this is what we are going to calculate. So this is our tau, this is our tau of this one, this is what we have to differentiate with respect to epsilon. So what will be the derivative of this with respect to epsilon? Derivative with respect to this argument into derivative of this with respect to epsilon, that is the first term. So let's write down everything, xa to xb, the limits there. So the first term will be partial derivative of this with respect to y into derivative of this with respect to epsilon, that will produce an eta, right? So that into eta plus derivative with respect to this variable dl by dy prime into derivative of this quantity with respect to epsilon, that is eta prime. So you get dl by dy prime this into dx. So the quantity that we are looking for has come to such a simple form. So we have dl by dy into eta plus dl by dy prime into eta prime. Are you all following this one? Now here we have a two terms. This involves eta, this involves eta prime. We want to manipulate this one so that this also involves eta and not eta prime. Okay? So consider the second term, which is integral xa to xb of dl by dy prime multiplied by eta prime dx. So it is again of the form of integral u dv. Remember whatever we did earlier, eta prime dx. This is d eta. So this becomes u, that is dl by dy prime. So this takes the role of u and this takes the role of dv with v equal to eta. That is the correspondence, integral u dv. So uv, u into v eta from xa to xb minus integral v du, so eta into d by dx of this quantity into dx from xa to xb. You are there. Any problem with that side? Alright. So we had this term here when we handled this, two terms. I am looking at this one now. So this particular one upon one partial integration comes to this. Since eta of xb and xa are 0, this vanishes. So you get this particular term. So add that one here. Now we can put this entire thing in the form of dl by dy into eta minus that quantity into eta. So eta is a common factor. So d by dx of so the derivative of this with respect to this at x equal to 0, this analog of the first derivative, right, of a function, that comes to this particular form here. This particular quantity, whatever comes here, okay, this quantity is called the variational derivative with respect to y. That is, this quantity, this is called the variational derivative. How does the function, okay, when the function changes, when the function y changes, how does the functional change? For a small change in the function, how does the functional change? That is what this is. So it is the derivative of this with respect to y, that is what it is. So we will denote by this symbol, delta of tau ab by delta of y. So this is dl by dy minus d by dx of dl by dy prime. Remember, if it is simply a function of y, the derivative would have been only dl by dy. But here it also depends upon first derivative because of this term here with a minus sign connecting them. Okay, I'll have more to say with respect to various other choices, okay? But in this case it is like this. Again, what I want to tell you here is something very simple. Suppose I have got a function of epsilon. I will say this is f of 0 plus epsilon times f prime of 0 plus etc. At every point epsilon, you can put it like this. Suppose I have got something like this, some a plus epsilon. I can write it as f of a plus f times f prime of a plus etc. So you make a small change in the argument of the function. Okay, then the change in the function is whatever is the change in the independent variable multiplied by first derivative. So corresponding to every epsilon, you get one answer here. Right? So this is the first order change. In F, when a change epsilon is made in the independent variable. Next term would be the second order change, F double prime of A. In this case, I would have put epsilon square by 2 into f double prime of 0. The difference between these two things is, here I am making an expansion about the origin, here I am making an expansion about a point, A. That's the only difference. So, first derivative at that particular point, second derivative at that point. Epsilon square, epsilon. First order change, second order change. Okay. Now, what we are saying here is now, supposing I have got a functional here, tau ab, okay, of y plus epsilon times eta. This is what we were doing here. This we said is equal to this functional evaluated at y plus epsilon times this quantity. Right? That's what it is. That is the first term here. So integral xa to xb of dl by dy minus d by dx of this into eta. So I'll bring this epsilon together there and put it here. Plus order of epsilon square. So look at the comparison. When I got a function here, I get just some one number here. When I now calculate the functional here with respect to y plus epsilon eta here, the first order change is given by epsilon eta over this entire interval multiplied by this quantity. Correct? But remember, everything is coming in an integral here. Because a functional is defined as an integral here. So variation of y over this entire interval is needed to find out what is the change in the functional. So the change in the first change in the functional comes in this particular way. So this quantity has to be compared with this one. These two are on equal footing. This is the derivative of a function. This stands for derivative of a functional. That's why this is called the functional derivative. So functional derivative doesn't involve the integral. Functional derivative is only this much, not within the integral. Change in the functional comes as an integral. Am I making sense to all of you? Yes? So this is the first order change in the functional here. Okay? And sometimes it's also called, if you some literature it may be called Fréchet derivative. This is a very useful concept. It comes in various. This is basically first few terms in the Taylor expansion of the function here. So corresponding to every epsilon, there is one single term here. to calculate here our functional, you remember, if this is the point xa and this is xb, this is that point xa y and this is the point xb yb, okay, to find out the length or the time, as the case may be, you have to use the data available in this entire interval, right? Now when I make a new function here, something like this is original function plus epsilon times eta here, to find out the net change in the functional, I need to find out what is the change taking place at every x and add them together, right? That's what this is doing. I say the first order change in tau is given by this quantity, but this quantity involves something which depends only upon y, the original path that we had considered, and the variation that we have incorporated. Two parts. The whole idea of doing a partial integration was to bring it to this particular form, so that I can say the change whatever is occurring here in y, okay, is what is coming here. So you use the information about the change in the dependent variable y over the entire interval of our interest, multiply that with this one, integrate to get the net change in the functional here. So this is the net change in the, I will say this is the first order change in tau. This is the net, this entire expression is the first order change in tau. So when you look at that closely, you find that it splits neatly into two parts. Something which depends upon the functional with which we started and the variation we have incorporated in our function here. Product of two terms here. Is that clear? Okay. It is like a moving derivative. When you go along the curve, df by dy, this dl by dy will basically tell you what is the change at a point by virtue of change in y. But y's derivative is also coming in our expression. So as you move along that one, not only y, but the first derivative also changes here. So this is like a moving derivative that we are going to take. In fact, okay, one second, I'll sum it up. So can I erase this one? Okay, fine. So like in the previous case, now we want our curve y to be very special. The path taken by the light ray to be something special. And that's obtained if this is entirely equal to zero. So if this vanishes, then you find that the path is such that even if there is a minor variation, still the time taken would not change to the linear order in epsilon. You also understand why I put an epsilon here now. Okay. Finally, epsilon eta, this is the net change that is there, that is what is coming here. Okay. So we can say the time is time taken if this expression . So this is a differential equation satisfied by y. It's a second order differential equation. So the y with the requisite property must satisfy this differential equation. Y has to be, of course, the solution has to satisfy the condition that y at xa that must be equal to ya and y at xb must be equal to yb. So you just do it as a boundary value problem. That's what is required. The exact working out of a specific problem will be done in the tutorial. Any doubts on this one, the methodology? Yeah, it is a functional derivative.
So there's a definition of functional derivative using Dirac delta function. That's easier.
No. This is the way. The formal way of doing it. If we have a functional, let's say something like this, I'll say some s of y equal to integral xa to xb l of y first derivative and x dx. It's an extremum or stationary if S of y in place of now epsilon eta, I will write it as some xi here. The epsilon was used just to motivate you, okay? So in place of epsilon and eta together, product, I put a new symbol here, minus S of y equal to order of psi square. That is, to the first order in psi, there should not be any change. Then we say it is an extremum. But what is this quantity? But S of y plus I minus S of y, this is equal to integral xi to xb, the first order term here. So this is the first order term. So our condition for extremum will be satisfied only if this is equal to 0. Okay? So this equal to order of epsilon square implies this quantity. This is what is called the Euler-Lagrange equation. So obviously, in this particular example, the function y should be such that y should be twice continuously differentiable. It's understood that y is a twice continuously differentiable function. So basically, the y is determined by solving the Euler-Lagrange equation. We'll have examples of that also. So we have to take it as a differential equation, solve it. So solve, so determine y of x by solving the differential equation. In this case with the boundary condition. Y of xA equal to yA and yB. That is the method. So we take it as a differential equation, solve it. Setting up the problem is always straightforward. Whether your particular problem is exactly solvable or not, that is a different problem altogether. Okay. Again, for the exercise, we can have one more problem that is called the Brachistokron problem. That I believe is the first, not the first problem. Yeah, history is also very interesting actually. Calculus is, of course, there only from the 17th century. Apparently, one is a hero. Hero had, I think he's lived in the 2nd century BC. He solved the problem of angle of reflection equal to angle of incidence in a medium with the constant refractive index by demanding that the path taken by light should be a minimum. He did not use calculus, but he arrived at that answer straight away. Then there is another person who is supposed to have started one city of Carthage. Okay. She went from, I think, Italy to Africa, one queen, and then she was looking for a place to settle. So she bargained with the local people. She had some money, and she said, whatever my ox hide, you know, the skin of the ox can cover, you give me that one for this money. People agreed. So what she did was to make some nice ribbon out of that hide and made into a big circle. No? So she said, whatever is within this perimeter, give me. and she maximized the area for a fixed perimeter. And that is a problem of calculus of variations, where the area which is a maximum for a fixed perimeter will turn out to be a circle. You can take that as an example. So she is supposed to be the first one to again use calculus of variations without calculus. Intuitively, it was obvious to her that the area is maximized by having a circle. A lot of history is there. But the one in the modern times after the advent of calculus is called the Brachistochron problem. So you can take it something like this. Let's say this is our xz plane. And let us think of some string is there. Let's say it is tied somewhere here, and you have got a bead in that one. So the bead slides down the string without friction. So the, mind you, this part is not fixed. This part is fixed. So you have to find out what is the shape of that curve over which it passes, so that the time taken is a minimum. So it has to basically go from this point. So I will call it, this is x and z here. So x a z a to some x b z b. So what is the shape? When I say shape, I mean what is the equation of that particular curve, okay? Shape of that string, which is the equation of the curve, for which time taken by the bead is a minimum. This is exactly solvable problem that also we will do in the tutorial. It's called the Brachistochron problem. So you can solve the problem of refraction, you can solve this problem, many others also, okay, but we have to judiciously use the time here. Okay. Now I will go to the mechanics part of it. Historically this is how it is. Okay.
The extremum, you said in most of the practical cases it will be a minimum.
Yeah.
So are there any examples where it goes to a maximum?
Yeah, because if there is any function, if you take the negative of that one, it can become a maximum, right? For example, let's say we are doing it in relativity, special relativity. We have to look at the invariant time. So I use the notation CT XYZ, okay, as the four coordinates of the space-time here. Then the invariant time d tau squared is given by C square dt square minus dx square minus dy square minus dz square. So now you take, well, simplicity, let me draw one space, one time here, x and CT here. Let's say now there is one space-time point here and there is some other space-time point here. You have to find out a curve in which case when you do the analysis you will find straightforward you will be taken to maximum. The maximum interval in the proper time. This is called the proper time. Tau is the proper time. So in this case, if you use the variational method here, that is you calculate the distance in this particular way, okay, that is you try to look at this quantity here, d tau square minus, well that is d tau square, okay, if you want to have this one, which is nothing but modulus of d tau here. So you integrate d tau here from one space-time point, let's say CT A to XB here. From this point to this point here, Okay, this quantity okay becomes a maximum. That is, when you extremize this one, the extremum you get here, I made a mistake there, I should not say maximize. You see, extremization of this quantity by the same method, whatever method I have outlined, leads to a maximum of proper time and not a minimum. This is like a geodesic. This is connecting two points in a space-time. Okay? But here the geometry is not Euclidean. We don't calculate distance by adding this here. It is subtracting there. If it is Euclidean space, we would have calculated the distances. This square plus this square plus this square plus this square. Whereas in Minkowski space, we just do this way. This is the way proper time is defined. So in this case, the very same method leads to a maximum of proper time.